We're starting the second lecture, which is by Benito, Marcote, and he will demonstrate some of the plotting tools in CASA that you will frequently use throughout this workshop. I'll give you 5 minute warning if you need to, Benito, but otherwise, go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Hope everyone hears me fine. I'm Benito Marcote, another of the ABN support scientists working at Jive in the Netherlands, Solga before. Well, everyone can contact in Mattermost if you need questions and everything at jive.marcote. And in this talk, I will try to make a summary and show all the plotting tools that you can find in CASA. Not only in CASA, at the very end, I will mention a couple of things that they exist outside CASA, but can work also with measurement sets. But the goal of this lecture is to show you which tools you can use to plot your data. Okay, in this lecture, we are not going to talk about what you should look at or how to identify problems. You will have other lectures in this week for that. But the goal is to get you comfortable and more friendly to use these tools, and at least knowing how to look at the data or what you can do with them. So the first part of the talk will be answering why you really care about plotting things. In this case, that in principle, you may think that you want just an automatic data reduction. But here, my purpose is to show you like you still really need to plot and see what are the solutions, what are your data, how it looks like. And that's the motivation of this lecture. And then I will give a summary of the three main plotting tools that you can find in CASA. Mainly PlotMS, that Olga already mentioned it, but it's a really powerful tool where you can see your data in completely different ways. I will also mention the Viewer, not only for showing images after you clean them, but also to look at the raw visibilities. And finally, we'll finish with the plot cal, which is the way that you may use to plot the calibrations. So first, you really need to know why plotting is important, even in packages like CASA. And the answers, you have different points, but basically it's a plot by plotting. It's the best approach that you can use to check how your data look like, not only at the beginning or during data reduction, but both of them. You can look at the data beforehand, so you may have a much better feeling on how your data look like and then how it is being calibrated. And this is important for all kind of observatories or data sets, but is in particular important in radio data and more especially in VLBI, because VLBI analysis still requires an important fraction of manual supervision, at least, or even manual tasks. So yeah, and that's quite critical or can affect significantly your results. So as you really need a high level of manual intervention here during VLBI data reduction, plotting is the best approach where you can be sure about what you are doing and what solutions you are getting, or if the data reduction is working properly. So that's why most of the plotting tools, or even this lecture, will focus on plotting at the stages during the data reduction, not just data analysis. We are not going to discuss that much, but what to look at the beginning and during your data reduction, because this is the only way that basically you have to be sure that your reduction is going into the right direction and you're not creating problems. So the main point that you should take from this lecture is that you should never trust blindly your data reduction, even if you create a pipeline that automatically reduces your VLBI data. You should always have a manual check of all the steps and what it is doing, because especially in VLBI, it's relatively easy that goes something at least in the wrong direction and can have some effects on your final data sets. So being said that, plotting is important because all these things, First, and even before data reduction, if you take a quick look at your data, you already have a feeling about how well, possible issues, or how sensitive, what sensitivity you have there. So you already have an a priori feeling about what to expect after your data reduction and from your results. And that's even before conducting any data reduction. But a part of that, B-plotting is typically the easiest way to identify some bad data, some noises, whatever, that can have completely different in nature. You may have always in an observation that lasts for several hours. You may have some times where either an antenna drop because any physical reason, or you have interferences, bright ones. And those things, if you leave the data there, it can already contaminate your final results. So it's always good to look at them, trying to flag and remove all this bad data before the data reduction or during it, if you detect them at those stages. And then you will always have much better results there. And one advice that we always do is that you have different tasks to conduct during the standard VLBI data reduction. It's always good and convenient to look at the solutions of those calibration steps. So after each of them, you can look at either the solutions or how you apply them later to the data. And then after each step, you can be sure that it's doing what you expect and you don't see any fancy result that it's unexpected there. And then is when you continue to the next step. So we are mentioning here that you really need to look at the data, but of course you need two things here. First, knowing what to look at, because you need to identify problems, you really need to know what to expect. And the other one is how to look at that data. So first, the very basic answer for what to should look at, you really need to keep in mind that during a CASA data reduction, you have two kind of data, let's say that. The actual data that are visibilities, they're complex numbers that contain amplitude and phases. And then you have the calibration solutions. As Olga mentioned, every time you run a calibration step, you will create a calibration table to apply to the data. So you can look at both things, the raw data or once corrected, or also the particular calibration tables that you have them. So both of them give you different, of course, information. Concerning the visibilities, you can, well, here we're talking about interferometers. So you always have antenna-based or baseline-based data. And you need to keep in mind that each visibility, it's basically a multidimensional, I mean, every measurement set is a multidimensional data. You have basically a visibility that is an amplitude and phase measurement. Four different parameters, like you have one visibility per baseline, which will observe per source. And then you have at different timestamps. So for each timestamp, you will have a visibility. And then you have, of course, divided by frequencies. You typically, in a VLBI observation, you divide your full bandwidth into different subbands, and each subband contains different channels. So for each channel, you will have a measurement of the amplitude and phases. And of course, you have different polarizations. So this gives you a really multidimensional data that you can play with, and then choosing, for example, two of those magnitudes, and then plot one against the other. And also that multiply by two because you have amplitudes and phases. So you really have a huge number of parameters where you can play with. And again, in this talk, I'm not going to explain you what to look at in detail or the calibration steps that you expect, or so how the data should be modified. You will see that in future lectures, mainly tomorrow. First, all the calibration basics, you could try to understand them tomorrow morning. And then there will be another talk by Ivan tomorrow afternoon, well, at 1:30, about what are the typical data problems and how to identify those ones. Okay, so here I will just focus on how to plot your data. And before that, two typical considerations that you always need to keep in mind, especially if you come from connected interferometers like PLA or more homogeneous ones. One is that you always need to keep in mind if your array, for different VLBI, this is different, it's homogeneous or is inhomogeneous, meaning if you, all your antennas in the array are exactly the same, like happened, for example, in the VLBA, or they are different antennas, like in the EVN. And this changes a lot what you will expect in the plots, because in an homogeneous array, you always expect all antennas to behave exactly in the same way. Their sensitivity should be the same. So if you look at different baselines, you may expect to see same levels of noise, for example, or same amplitudes. However, in an inhomogeneous one, this is not true. You may have a really sensitive baseline, for example, in the AVN, one baseline that goes to FSberg, which is typically the largest disk. And if you have a receiver, that baseline is really sensitive, but then you may have baselines that are way less sensitive than that. So you cannot be, you shouldn't be surprised if you have a baseline that apparently is really noisy, but that's normal. It's just because that baseline is less sensitive than other ones. So you need to keep that in mind when you look at the data. And the other one is that here we are dealing with VLBI, really long baselines, but you still have relatively short baselines. And that means that most of the sources may be resolved, means that the fluxes may vary with the length and even the orientation of your baselines. So even for a calibrator, you may not expect to see the same amplitude for different baselines. Okay, that this is not common for compact interferometers. So let's go to the first task, the first tool, sorry, plot MS. Olga already mentioned it. You can use it in two ways. One is from inside CASA, and then you just need to call plot MS and the typical parameters that you can provide, like the measurements that you can read, and you can even specify what you want to plot at, the x-axis, the y-axis, and other parameters. But actually, you can also use it outside CASA. You don't need to run CASA to use PlotMS. And in that case, you can directly type CASA PlotMS in the terminal, and then it will run. One difference is that we notice that you don't have the, at least directly, you don't have the CASA PlotMS call in CASA 6.06.1. So probably that changed because PlotMS is still under heavily development. So that may change, but for now you only have this call in CASA 5.7 or before. And PlotMS is really powerful because it allows to look at your data in completely different ways, and it's completely interactive. So you can quickly change from one side to the other. At the end, you are always looking at exactly the same data. Okay, so you only have one measurement set and you are plotting the visibilities, either if they are before calibration or after. However, you can look at the same data in completely different ways. And that's the important part of PlotMS. It allows you to look at the data completely with different axes, so you see different perspectives there, and you may identify issues or how it's going in one view, but not in the others. So that's why it's always convenient to look at your data from different perspectives there. If you are inside CASA, you may know that you have two different forms to call any task, not only PlotMS. First, be aware that you always can use the question mark to get the help of the task, what it does, and also which parameters you can put them. And then you can call it just like a standard Python function, the name of the task, and then the parameters inside brackets. But for those of you that come from Apes, maybe are more familiar with kind of Apes syntax, where you can, let's say, preload a task with default parameters, then fix all of them to some options. You can always do an input to show all the parameters and which values are currently set. And finally, run the task with empty brackets. Those two syntaxes are completely equivalent here, but each of you can decide which one is more familiar for you. So going to plot the mesh, what you can plot or what is the typical looks that you can take at the measurement sets that you have at your observation. The first one probably is like you may want, especially for VLBI datasets, you may be interested in looking at the UV plane. Okay, so here you plot the visibilities in the UV axis, which gives you already an idea about how well you will reconstruct basically the sky image. Okay. This is an interferometer, so you know the maximum UV distance, so the maximum separation between visibilities will give you an idea about the resolution that you can reach. Whereas the minimum one, and it's always keep that in mind, it tells you about the largest angular scales that you are sensitive to. So you know that any emission larger than that, you will not see in the map. And of course, the better you reconstruct the UV plane, the better, the more accurate your final images will be with respect to the sky. So you know that if you only have one baseline, so two telescopes, you do an observation, you only have one point in the UV plane, plus if it's complex conjugate. But in that case, you only recover from the sky a sinusoidal pattern. You cannot say more. If you observe for longer time, it will you will get more visibilities, and this is due to the Earth rotation. So you may reconstruct better, and then you are able to say that there is a point-like source in the center. But the better you reconstruct the UV plane with more baselines, the better your final image will be. So this UV plane is typically one of the first plots that you can do, because it already gives you an idea about how well your images or the images will be. You will get more probably in the talks about the imaging, but this is already a good, yeah. Then we can move to how your amplitudes vary versus the frequency, because as I mentioned before, in a typical VLBI observation, you are splitting your subbands, your bandwidth into different subbands. In this case, we are splitting into 8. This kind of a typical value for continuum observations. And you can see that the amplitudes, they always drop roughly to 0 at the edges of each subband. And then you have the base, the normal amplitude or a kind of flat amplitude there. Here we are plotting basically amplitude versus frequency. And for all baselines to the first bar station, that in case of the AVN is the most sensitive antenna. So you, and the color ones are different antennas, so different baselines. You can see that the amplitudes are different for different baselines. We expect they are, you may have different flags for different UV distances for your source. And you know that all of them follow the same pattern. So otherwise here you just see what's your one pass shape, the original one. If you conduct the one pass calibration, as you will see in tomorrow's lectures and more of them, the idea is that you know that this is an artificial pattern. You know that the amplitudes in this limited bandwidth will be exactly the same for each source from the beginning, from the lowest frequency to the highest one. So that's why you run a bandpass calibration to get rid of this artificial instrumental shape. And then what you will see later is that all the amplitudes will be, well, in this case, normalized to 1, because it's just the correction that we are applying, but flat. Okay, you see the same amplitudes at the center of your subbands or at the edges. So this is one of the things that you can compare with PlotMS. It's like every time you do the calibration steps and you apply, you know that it's doing what you expect. You have the raw data, and then after a one pass calibration, this is what you will expect. But those are just some examples of plots. if you run plot MS without any argument, only the measurement set that you want to load, this is what you will typically see. By default, it puts an amplitude versus time, and it loads all your data. So all sources, all subbands, channels, times, which may be tricky if you have a really large data set, because either it will take long or it can directly run out of memory. But this is the simplest way to load your data. And this is the PlotMS window. So you have a large number of tabs and parameters plus other options in the bottom. Way to plot your data? Well, because as we mentioned, it's the easy way to spot problems. Here you have the amplitude versus time. There are different sources. You already see that, okay, there may be some spikes and some data issues at some particular times. So the thing that you want with PlotMS is to identify the bad data and what you should remove. Again, in this one, we are not going to focus on how to identify these issues. You will have other lectures. But let you know that in PlotMS, you want, basically, you can change everything you want. So every user will have its style to look at the data. But here you can customize and be more convenient for you. So the first thing, for example, is like you can put different colors to different things. So in this case, you can want a different color for different source. So you may be able to distinguish if you have different amplitudes that they do belong to different sources. But you can also color by baseline, antenna, even subbands or channels. Okay, so depending on the plot that you are doing, you can choose the most convenient color scheme there. And if we go to the main data panel, here is where you have all the properties that you can set. So you can specify a particular field, so a particular source to plot. Otherwise, it will show everything. And then you can specify, for example, the numbers of which subband and channels you want. CASA has this syntax where SPW, that is the spectral window, you can choose the number of the subband that you want. So you may specify a star to plot all subbands, just a range, so 5-6, or just a single subband. And then after column, you have the number of channels or which channels you want to show. Remember, you have different channels per subband. So in this case, we are plotting subbands 5 and 6 and only the channels from 10 to 30 in those ones. So basically you can personalize completely that one. So specify a time range, even cutting by UV ranges if you only want to show long distances or short ones, and specify different antennas or even baselines. So here you can put the name of the antennas or an ampersand if you want a baseline. In this case, we are showing all baselines to FSWare, which for most of the purposes is typically the most common thing to choose to pick the strongest reference antenna and then show all of those ones. And the polarizations, in this case called correlations. So we are only plotting the direct ones. And we are coloring by source. So you see that some of them have different amplitudes as expected. And there are some faint ones that have lower amplitudes. In the bottom panel, you have different options. Of course, you have something for zoom in, zoom out, going back to the original plot. But the interesting part, this is not only for plotting, you can do something with the data. So first you can select, well, you can put some selection boxes. With the plus, you can set like here, tiny, or with the mouse, you select a box. And with the minus, you can remove it or put more. And with this, you can select some subset of these visibilities, and then you can retrieve information about those ones. So for example, if you have something like here, really low amplitudes, you may be interested about, okay, which ones are these visibilities? So for that, you have the magnifier, and then in the normal log window from CASA, you will get, oops, sorry. You will get the properties of those visibilities, so to what it they belong to. So in this case, you have a line per single visibility that you had in the plot, but you see that all these ones here belong to the same baseline. In this particular case, the one from FSBER to SV, SVETLU, so antennas 0 to 6. You see that you have different subbands, a single channel, but it's the only one that we are showing. And curiously, this is only one polarization, the right and right. So VLBI uses circular polarization, right and left. So from here, you can identify that all these low amplitudes belong to the same baseline and the same polarization, for example. And it's really straightforward to identify what's the origin of that data that you are looking at. And additionally, you have two buttons to flag or unflag those data. So you can always set a box, and then with the flag, you can flag those data sets, those data points. And they will be stored in the measurement shell. But you don't only need to show amplitudes versus time. You can always change the X and Y axis. You have, for example, UV distance versus amplitude. In the column property, you can set data, which means the raw data, or the corrected column, that is the one containing the most up-to-date calibrated data that you've applied to your data set. So as we mentioned before, here you have a source that is typical in VLBI, is a bit resolved, and that means that in the short baselines, you have higher amplitudes and lower at the other ones. And we are following from through baselines or antennas. In this case, so you see that a particular antenna had really low amplitudes here, where the other one, the same data set, but some other set of these visibilities had relatively consistent amplitudes with the other ones. So again, if you do a box, you see that this is exactly the same as we were seeing before. It's the same baseline and only one polarization, meaning that that polarization was probably broken. So you can actually flag that data with the flag. And the final thing that you can do with PlotMS is that you can iterate through different properties. So you may, for example, want this plot, but for different sources. You don't want to combine different sources in this kind of plots, because then you will have different amplitudes and then you don't see any difference. So you can iterate through sources, scans, subbands, even antennas. And then with the green buttons here, the arrows, you can go to the next plot and the previous one. So it's really quick to see differences, for example, between baselines. And for example, if we move back to amplitude versus time, and then we go through different baselines, you can see that all of them look fine, but then you find a particular baseline where you see these amplitudes that are consistent in time. Each color is a different source. So in this case, we see that suddenly the amplitudes for this source drop to zero, or roughly to zero. So this is already telling you that, okay, at those times, you lost the signal for a reason, and you may want to get rid of all this data in those times. So that's something that is easy if you cycle between different baselines, for example. So with PlotMS, this is the main objective that you can use for. You can identify times where the data seem to drop for unexpected reasons. All this was about amplitudes, because typically, it's easier to spot difference in the raw data there. Yeah. But you can always, again, change all your axes to what you want to see, go through all the possibilities, and then you may spot issues in one way, but not in another one. Of course, you can also plot phases, but with raw data, what happens? That you have radio interferometers and you have uncalibrated data. So if you plot that for all fields and all frequencies, the uncalibrated data will look something like this. You haven't calibrated the phases, so they will evolve with time, and then you probably don't see, or you see a really tiny structure. However, if you conduct your typical calibration that you could learn during these days, you will expect afterwards something like this. So all faces, this is a calibrator, bright one. So you will expect that the faces are roughly fitting into zero and constant in frequency or even in time. Okay, so all these things is, they are the possibilities that you can do with plot MS. Sorry. Then we can move to the second tool that you can find in CASA. This is Viewer. Most of you, if you've already worked with CASA, will be familiar with this one just to show images. As Olga mentioned in the previous lecture, you can plot either the results from the imaging in CASA or even plot feeds files if they are if they belong to a image. However, this is not the only use that you can do with Viewer. And here I will focus on this second use that is less known, but it can be useful for you. Again, similar to plot MS, you can call it through inside CASA by Viewer or also outside as CASA Viewer. And this can be even a nice replacement or alternative to DS9, for example, or KVs if some of you use it. So you can use it completely independently of CASA, and it can also read FITS files. So again, most of you, if you've used CASA, you will be familiar with the imaging viewer. You will probably get a more detailed lecture during the cleaning one that I think is on Wednesday, and then you will use it, and even during the workshops. But however, you can also use it to plot visibilities. And compared to plot MS, this one is a completely different approach, and it gives you basically an extra dimension to compare the data. What happens with that one is that if you directly call a measurement set and open it in Viewer, you will probably get something like this. That, okay, it's not the most user-friendly, and probably you are not sure what you are seeing there. But basically what Viewer does is plotting all your data, all your visibilities, and per baseline in the x-axis. So here you have the antenna zero and all baselines to antenna zero. So zero to antenna one, zero to antenna two, three, four. Then you jump to antenna one, antenna two, and then you iterate all the baselines to antenna two, two and three, 2 and 4, 2 and 5, etc. And the y-axis in this case is time. And the color is the amplitudes that you have in the data. And of course, this is only for a particular channel. You can iterate through different channels. So again, at this point, I agree that this is not helpful, or you cannot see anything. You see white stripes, so there is something bright and belongs to the first antenna probably, but there is not that much information that you are getting here. So you need to customize it a little bit. Again, you have different options to zoom in, zoom out, move, and also do selections. But you have the option to open the settings, and this is equivalent to the left panel that you saw in PlotMS. So here is telling you what is loaded. For example, which sources, in this case, all of them. And here they are using only the numbers. So source 0, 1, 2. It's plotting all subbands. And then you have the axis. So baseline versus time. And here you have by default what to do with the flag data or those spaces where you don't have data. So by default, those are the blue stripes that sometimes is confusing. So for the purpose of this lecture, I will make it as easy as possible. I typically remove that one. So just mask with background. So now all black is where you don't have data. Still, this is not giving you too much information, but you can also change the color maps. You have different options again and change the levels even. And now at least you are getting a bit more information or feedback. You see different amplitudes for different baselines and the almost all of them are kind of constant in time. I prefer in particular black and white, so I think to show you the tool is better. We remove the colors, just put in a different color map. And the very last change before discussing what you are showing is that you can order the x-axis. And instead of ordering by baselines, by the number of antennas, that is an artificial thing, you can order by baseline length. So this is kind of the amplitude versus UV distance plot. But now you have an extra dimension, which is time. And the amplitudes are just the brightness of the plot. So this is actually the same as the plot that you saw in PlotMS. And you see that, OK, you have larger amplitudes on short baselines, and then just more noisier ones, lower amplitudes on the long ones, which is actually what you expect. So this is kind of powerful tool, in particular, to detect RFI, because suddenly you will see a bright spot somewhere. Or like here, you expect something to drop in amplitude smoothly from short to long baselines. But here you see some stripes that contain more amplitudes that you will expect according to what is nearby for those UV distances. So those are the things that you can look with Beaver. Actually, you can also flag data here. You can do a selection, which is either a box, a circle, or just a random shape. So with your mouse, you can select something. Like here, for example, this bright stripe, like if happen after calibration and I don't want that because it's really bright, I just select that and then you double click inside that box. So the data there will be flagged. And this is one of the modes, time versus baselines, but it has another approach, which is time versus channels. So here you only show a baseline at a time, and then you can iterate versus for the different baselines. So this is the complement of the previous one. You had time versus baselines per channel, and this one is time versus channel per baseline. So this is uncalibrated data. This is basically what you saw before. At the edges of the subband, you see amplitudes of almost zero, and then quite consistent or smooth amplitudes at the central band. Okay, so there is nothing that pops up here. But if we go to a different baseline, you may expect RFI, for example, and this is what you will see. So in this kind of plots, it's really easy to spot the presence of RFI at some particular times. Of course, the general amplitudes, this is just this color map, scales down. So those are the amplitudes similar to the previous plot. But here you have really strong times or spots because RFI contaminated data. So this is something that is maybe easier in Beaver to spot and maybe flag. Again, each user has different styles and someone prefer one tool than the other. You may try all of them and then stay with the ones that are more comfortable to you. One remark about Beaver is that it doesn't automatically store the flag data or the flaggings to your data set, as opposed as PlotMS. So before closing Beaver, always remember to, it's in the same window where you have the parameters, click and press save edits. Otherwise you will miss all the flagging things that you've done in the data. And finally, the third plot, that was it about Beaver. The final one is PlotCal, which is the one that allows you to plot calibration tables. As I mentioned in the beginning, and what I've been explaining until now, is how to plot visibilities, either calibrated or uncalibrated. But then you also have the calibration tables, which are the products or the solutions obtained for each calibration step that you've run in CASA. Unfortunately, this is one of the tools that are only available up to CASA 5.7. So the idea is that all this functionality will migrate to PlotMS. So you will be able to open calibration tables, and most of them are already working, so you can open in PlotMS. However, for example, the calibration tables produced by Frame, the Frame fitting, they are not working in PlotMS. So this is one of the reasons why in this workshop we are at least keeping CASA 5.7.
5 minutes, Benito.
Oh, yeah, okay. Well, excuse me. So this is one of the tasks that you will not find in CASA 6. And in the future versions, everything will be working in PlotMS, exactly in the same way. So in this case, we are not plotting visibilities, but only the calibration tables. You will have a different external file in the same working directory that belongs to each calibration step that you've done. So you can plot the individual calibration tables there. And it's always convenient to look at the solutions that you got there before applying them to the data, because in some cases you can still improve or remove some bad solutions. The syntax is the same as in other CASA tools, the function, and then you can call the calibration table that you want to open, define your X, Y axis. Of course, depending on which calibration steps you're done here, you will want to show different magnitudes. And then you can do subplots to iterate through different antennas instead of combining all of them in the same plot. So for example, this is the solution for the gain calibration of VLBI data, which is the system temperatures. You will really see more in detail in the next lectures, probably from Mark, about what is this calibration. But for now, let's say that you can open all the solutions that you have, and you have for the different antennas, in this case, as we mentioned, frequency versus system temperatures, what are the solutions that you could apply to your data. So you may already spot like, okay, a part of the uncertainties that you may have for all of them. In some of them, you may have solutions that already look a bit lower than what you will expect. So you may flag here interactively with the mouse and then keep only the good ones. Or versus time, you notice the same differences. These are exactly the same antennas as before. So for different sources, the system temperature may be slightly different, but it's kind of consistent along the time. There's a few drops that you had here. And one antenna was using just the theoretical respected values. So we didn't have any real data to compare. So you may know that, okay, during the data reduction, you may check how accurate is this gain calibration for that antenna. You can always plot all the different calibration tags. For example, the solution from the fringe fitting. In this case, you may see the evolution of the phases versus time for different baselines. And as typically happens for different baselines, the phases may evolve differently, faster or slower. But this is quite critical because for most of the calibration steps, you always set an integration time. So sometimes where you will just combine all the solutions there. And that's critical in these cases because, of course, you want a solution that is as sorted as possible to track and correct all the variations that you see in your data. However, at some point, if it's too short, you will just feed noise. But on the other hand, you want a solution interval as long as possible because then you will have a much higher signal to noise. So it's always a compromise between how fast this evolves and how long, how short the solution intervals you will look at. So this is what you should always check and try to infer what is the best times there. So I will just finish in two slides. Something that you can find outside CASA, but it helps you also to look exactly the same data. One is JPlotter or JivePlot. This is a local task that which is being developed here at Jive. And you can do exactly something similar to PlotMS. You can plot the visibilities, amplitude, phases versus time versus frequency or channels. and it's really fast. It's completely outside CASA, so you can run it standalone. And then you can quickly define what you want. Read a measurement set, define the baselines, frequencies that you want, and plot it, and even say a multi-page plot. So this is really fast compared to plot a mesh, for example. Something which is similar in appearance to Beaver is to plot, again, like time versus channels per baseline, AO flagger, and it's really convenient to flag your data, and you see similar plots here. So it's really convenient to identify and also flag all that RFI if your data is contaminated. And I will just finish with something that Ilse mentioned before, which is Cartag. That is a new Beaver that will allow you to do a quick analysis of your data. This is for the final images or data products that you are getting. So it's still under heavy development, but it aims to be the basically replacement for DS9, or it can be an alternative to DS9 KVs, or even, as mentioned before, CASA-VLBI that can be used in the same way. So I will not put into details on these ones, but everyone can take a look and then start using them if they have preferences on them. So that was it. That was the summary about plotting.
Thanks, Benito. That was well done time-wise, just a minute over, but lots of very important stuff to share. So I'll hand over to Jack for some questions. I see there's a few already popping up.
Awesome. Yeah. Thanks again, Benito. That was great. I will try and do the questions in order, but I'm sorry if I get them out of order because they're coming through different areas. So I think the first one came from Paul very early on. So in your first slide about CASA plot MS command, it was near the start. At least there was a comma there, which wouldn't work if you do it in the command line. So I at least tested it. So there should be a,
okay.
I think a with, just needs to be removed for everyone else's knowledge going forward. The next one from Venkat, I was asking, are there plans to include Stokes-I in plot MS? The current version only allows iterating over the individual correlations, but not in Stokes. Does anyone know, either you, Benito, or CASA dev folk?
Well, probably some Ilse or someone may know. I know that when you select RR and LL, it's not exactly intensity, but at least in the current version, yeah, you cannot directly set direct intensity. I'm not completely sure about the developments for the future versions.
I haven't recently checked. I'm not sure. Mark, do you know anything about this?
I don't even have an idea what plotting Stokes I is for raw visibilities. So would that just be the sum of LL and RR?
Yeah.
I don't think that's possible. You can definitely plot LL against RR, and that will give you some ideas about the things that are not Stokes I.
But, yeah, so I don't know if there are plans to incorporate that.
This is probably, so plot MS is developed by folks at NREO, and we don't really do anything with that. So if there's requests of that kind, getting them to NREO would probably be the best approach.
Yeah, I think from me at least, I think you can do plot Stokes I in AO flagger, but I'm not too sure about that. I think you can. So that's all that I know. So the next one from Mikhail is, can keyboard shortcuts be modified in plot MS? I don't think so, but other people might have a different one.
Not as far as I'm aware. So yeah. The other thing is that plot MS is under heavy development, or they are doing a new kind of version. So a part of the port to CASA 6, they are not redesigning, but doing a major change for plot MS. So wouldn't be surprised if there are significant differences for the new ones. So not improvement in the current ProDMS, but something that will be changed in the future versions or replacements.
Yeah, in general, the move is more towards standalone tools that are on top of the CASA functionality. So I can imagine that then at some point, the GUI will also be more interactive and more flexible for users to assign certain functionality to it.
Yeah,
but that's, yeah, I think because that's
right now, depending on the system operative that you have, even mentioning the window may not be easy or they have some constraints. So
I think that's a kind of an important thing to say, is like kind of the standardization of the measurement set means that you, as well as CASA, you've got all these extra tools which are available and can use it and use the underlying, you know, CASA core modules to get things done, which is where lots of these extra tools are coming from. Another question, when flagging in viewer using the selection function, how can you unflag if you don't like the flagging or there was some mistake before?
You have also a button, it's similar to ProDMS. So you have another button to unflag, if I'm saying it correctly. The problem with that, and it's also the problem in ProDMS, like you may have different levels of flagging. But if you press the unflag, it will unflag absolutely everything that is behind that selection. So sometimes you unflag things that actually they were not the things that you want to unflag partially. So in the general case, it works similar to ProDMS. I think you can make a selection and have a button to unflag it. Otherwise, you just need to go to the measurement set again and unflag it through the command line, which will give you the same behavior.
Okay. So the other one is, when flagging in viewer, can I save the flags in a different flag version table as with ProDMS?
Not as I am aware. I'm not sure if when you call it, you may assign, but probably not. Don't think it's the same as ProDMS. You cannot directly create a defined flag inversion table for those ones. I'm not sure if by default it creates or it does a backup from the previous one, and then the new generated flagging goes into the new one. So in that case, you can go to the previous table, but not through Beaver. You cannot set which table you want there.
Is that also true for the Oh, no, that is the viewer, right? Where you showed the RFI flagging. That was not ProDMS.
Yeah, Beaver. Yes, yeah, for that one.
Mixing things up.
So all the flaggings that you do will be stored at the same time because it's only when you save them. So at least it will only be stored in one step. It's not creating one per box or flagging that you do.
Okay, and I think Miguel was next from Mattermost. So nice overview, Benito, but what about repeatability? So most of these tasks take a long time to do interactively, but this is not repeatable, as you know, it's the same with apes when you do it in TV flag, right? So this is important for RFI. So kind of what tasks are available, how reliable they are to correct RFI, and you know, are they fast and how difficult it is to tune them?
That's always the problem there. So first you always need a compromise, or you need between what you use, how interactively or how easy it is to identify, and how you perform the flaggings. So for repeatable uses, of course, what will be better, or I think so more, advisable, is to, you may identify the things, and for example, that's what I typically do with ProDMS. Try to identify what data needs to be flagged, but then doing it manually, just running, you flag in apes, and in this one is flag, UV flag. So of course, with that one, you manually set what you want to flag. So you have that written down, it's in the log, and you can run it at any time. At least here, you can, everything is stored in a flagging table, so you can always recover the previous ones, or you can apply those ones. So at least you have a table keeping record of the flagging. But of course, if you do it manually, you are missing what you're flagging, or yeah, exactly what data you flagged. And that's something that at the end, it cannot be avoided if you do with anything interactive. Doesn't matter which tool you do. So of course, the advice is like everything that can be done through the command line or keeping a record of those ones should be done by that. But at the same time, I mean, you're using the tools only to identify the data to flag and then do it through the terminal. So you have a record of that. That's always the ideal case. But of course, it's not that quick, so, or convenient in some cases. So at the end, you always have the trade-off. And I think that's more an open discussion. But you have backup tables. You may have a log of what you flagged. But if you want a really detailed log, then you need to do it through the command line.
I think we have time for one more question, if there is one.
Yeah, so we've got one more here. Is there an easier way to transport a flagger flags to CASA prior to calibration?
I'm not sure about that one.
So as far as I know, AF flagger writes the flags directly. So the best way to track them is to do a save your flag tables before, and then you can revert back if you don't like what AF flagger has done. And it writes the flags directly, so it doesn't change the flag versions or things like this. So you need to make a backup before you do it.
Okay. I think that applies for most of the tools, actually.
Yeah, I think that the flagging is by default is an issue which is tricky in CASA sometimes, as you showed. You can do it through interactive tools, you can do it through command lines, you can make a list of your own flags that you want to apply. And it does require significant bookkeeping to do this properly, especially if you want to do it repeatable. But we're running towards the end of this question session. I noticed, Benito, you had a few links to software packages in your slides, and I'll add them to the CASA wiki for people to quickly access them there.
So yeah, and the slides are already in the wiki, so you can actually open them and use them.
You were a bit blurry. I think your bandwidth was sort of suffering, so it was good to have them on the wiki so we could see. It was just visible.
Okay,
thank you, Benito. That was really educational. I've never even used Viewer myself to inspect visibility, so I learned something new myself. So I'll